Thank you very much for this invitation. I would like to congratulate you for organizing this webinar during this crisis time, because you're actually doing a social service by motivating everyone to be active and forget about all the worries of COVID-19. So my topic today is art of writing literature review articles. We all know that literature review is important to understand the research gaps, what is already done and what is to be done. But some of us are not having clarity when it comes to publishing a literature review based paper. You have done a literature review chapter for PhD thesis. A lot of people do that, or those who are doing PhD, they have to do it. But sometimes supervisors forget to tell them the purpose of review chapter, the purpose of review literature review chapter, or purpose of a literature review article, and how to articulate that. This is what is the focus of my session today. I would like to encourage you to ask a couple of questions after 15 or 20 minutes. We can have two breaks for questions and answers after 15, 20 minutes. Then we can have my talk and then towards the end, twice. So question and Q&A session twice. So let me... let me move my slides. Let me begin with some experience sharing, or what I have done in the recent years, or what I'm doing, and why I'm talking about literature review today. Last year, I had an opportunity to be the lead guest editor for review papers for International Business Review and Aggregate Journal, and we got 75 submissions, and I handle 75 review papers as editor. This year I'm doing for Journal of Business Research, and we got 125 submissions, and it was a lot of work, but I learned a lot of things by reading all those submissions or going through all the submissions. Some of them, when you get 120 papers, you don't have enough time to read, but at least you can glance through, and then you can rely upon reviewers, what reviewers say as well. And as an author, I ventured into writing review papers when I started teaching in PhD program. So originally, in the early stages of my career, I was a faculty member. I was an assistant professor with IIM in India. But when I moved abroad, I realized that what research is done in India is not at all enough. And in India, people don't even know what is a literature review article. People just know SPSS. These days, people know Smart PLS. So research in business management is all about SPSS and Smart PLS. So what is beyond that? So what is not really, where can I pitch in? So I started reading different types of research papers. I started reading conceptual papers, also empirical paper, all kind of papers, literature review, because if you have to teach in a PhD program, in all the American universities involved 2 years of intensive coursework. So when I, took up when I moved from Japan to America, and then I started teaching in PhD program. So I had to prepare courses relating to what is, so consisting of different types of research papers. And that time I read more than 15 literature review articles published in different journals, and tried to understand all those kind of things. In addition to, I already knew how to do an empirical, how to write an empirical paper. But at that time, this was about 8 years ago, I didn't know how to write a literature review paper. But from zero, these days, I do have 14 literature review papers published as an author, and a couple of them are in pipeline. And then I probably 14 literature review papers, not many people have published 14 literature review papers. So that in terms of number and in terms of exposure, I learned a lot by reading and writing literature review papers. So I'm also editing special issue for literature review papers for Asia Pacific Business Review currently. And last 3 years, I also gained a lot of experience as an associate editor or senior editor of European Management Journal, Service Industries Journal, International Journal of Emerging Markets, and those kind of journals. But some of those positions I've already left recently because I have to focus on my editor-in-chief position of International Journal of Consumer Studies, because that's a lot of responsibility, and we are working towards goal-oriented towards creating or to transcend International Journal of Consumer Studies into greater heights. Currently it's ranked in Australia list, but our goal is to have at least 4 or 5 impact factor very soon. So I would like to use some of this, my experiences as an editor, to share some insights with you. And let me start with the importance of literature review. Why do we do literature review? I tell you, when I did my PhD, I didn't know why we do literature review. I didn't actually understand, because my supervisor didn't tell me the importance of what is the importance of literature. Why do we have a chapter in PhD thesis, a literature review chapter? I didn't understand. And you know, it is because sometimes you do certain things without understanding. So you are not happy with that, but you should understand the purpose. So the basic purpose of literature review, or why literature review is important, a subject I mentioned in my first sentence here in my PPT, why review article or why review chapter in thesis? A subject, the answer is, a subject advances when studies are designed in a way that adds value based on the findings of prior studies. So you have to understand the purpose of literature review is to analyze the findings of prior studies and pool studies with similar findings in you know, together, and segregate studies with different type of findings in a different table or in a different structure. So the basic purpose is you have to understand the subject advances when literature review identify research gaps and point out directions for future research in a very clear and very scientific way, focusing on the findings of prior studies. If you don't focus on findings of prior studies, your literature review is not going to be useful. Your literature review is not going to be insightful. So you have to focus on findings of prior studies. It is important. And let me give you some evidence for why or the importance of literature review. There is a journal called International Journal of Management Reviews. It's called IJMR. It's from British Academy of Management in UK. IJMR is a relatively young journal, but IJMR's impact factor is 7.6. 45-year-old journals struggle to create an impact factor of 3+. But at the same time, IJMR is just a 20-year-old journal, has 7.6 impact factor. This is because IJMR publishes only literature reviews, and literature reviews are much more impactful, provided they are crafted in a structured and scientific way. There's another journal, Journal of Economic Literature. Journal of Economic Literature publishes literature reviews in the area of economics. It's called JEL. JEL is a famous acronym. And JEL also is considered as Gita or Bible of researchers in the subject area of economics. So these two are classic examples for literature reviews, and these two gives us enough support to talk about the importance of literature review. And literature review is also important in medical sciences field. They give a lot of importance, but you have to focus on findings of prior studies in a literature review. That is a prerequisite. Moving on to next slide. Purpose of a review article is to provide new ideas and directions in order to help future researchers to undertake novel research. instead of doing recycle type of research. When you develop a review article, you have to keep in mind that you have your job is to find out what kind of research or what research is done in a recycled way. Everybody has used multiple regression analysis. That means there is no novelty in multiple regression analysis. That means in your review article, you have to suggest that so many people have used multiple regression analysis. There is no more scope for using multiple regression analysis. People need to think about new methods. And if everybody has used theory of planned behavior, there's no point in using the same theory again and again in future studies. So when you do a review analysis, your job is to find out, identify what methods, what theories are repeatedly used in your domain, in your subject area, and suggest directions for future research and new ideas based on that. So you have, suppose you find that, let's say agency theory or transaction cost theory is not used by people in this area. There is scope for using those theories. Or let's say, some structural location modeling is not used in this area. Can we use structural location modeling in case if other researchers have not used? If other researchers have used technology acceptance model left and right in this area, 1,000 studies are published, 500 studies are published using technology acceptance model. There is no scope for using same model again. Then you have to suggest, we have already used, a lot of researchers have already used technology adoption model in a repeatedly and recycled way. So we need to develop new models to substitute technology acceptance model. So that means there is scope for developing new theoretical models and use that in your studies rather than using same old wine technology acceptance model every now and then. So you need to find new theories. There are new theories and models developed, but researchers are reluctant to find what are the new theories and models developed last 5 years because it takes more time to search for new theories. And they always like to use very, very old 50-year-old theories, 40-year-old theories, same old wine in new bottle. So you have to identify what is already widely used and what is not yet widely used. And you have to recommend what can be used, what methods, what theories, what variables and constructs can be used in future research. That should be the purpose of your review article. So the purpose of review article help to avoid recycle type of research in future, provided you provide effective directions for future researchers. Topic selection, this is the next point. You need to select a topic for review. For example, you have already done PhD in a specific area. So if you have not published your literature review paper, you can try to publish this as a literature review paper. There are several journals considering literature review papers, including International Journal of Consumer Studies. We have called for special issue for review articles. Submission window is already open and it will, we have a kind of preference for classic literature review articles these days because they are more insightful and they are more helpful. And you can also think about other journals as well. And when you select a topic, you have to look at whether there are other reviews published on the same topic in recent years. You can do this, you can do a search on Google Scholar and find out whether there are other reviews on the same topic, So in case if there are other reviews published in your area during last 3 years or last 2 years or last 4 years, there is no scope for another review. In case if there is another review on the same topic 5 years ago or 10 years ago, at least you have some scope because you can review, you can focus on last 5 years or last 10 years articles, and then you can analyze it and then you can provide insights for future directions, future research and so on. So this is an important thing to look at in the beginning. Otherwise, sometimes journal editors or journal reviewers will find out there are other reviews and they will not consider your review. This is a problem that you have to keep in mind, that you have to understand that if there is a very recent review on the same topic, there is no scope for repeating the same job and try to publish another review. So yeah, so I mentioned here, editors and reviewers do not want to consider reviews on topics when there is another comprehensive review, another recent comprehensive review already available. I tell you an example. Social entrepreneurship. Social entrepreneurship, there are 6 reviews. And you know, recently, this was last year, one of the professors from MDI in India approached me to co-author a paper on social entrepreneurship. I was reluctant and was looking at, there were many reviews on social entrepreneurship, and it was tough for us to publish this paper because many editors and reviewers find that there are several other reviews. And similarly, IIT Kharagpur PhD student approached me to co-author a paper on service recovery last year. I literature review paper because his research area was service recovery. There are a couple of other reviews on service recovery. If there are other reviews on service recovery, then the good journals, premier journals, are not happy to consider this. This is a problem. International franchising. I co-authored and published a literature review on international franchising, Journal of Business Research. This was published 2 years ago. Yeah, 2.5 years now. And this is one of the most downloaded paper from Journal of Business Research these days. And immediately after that, another researcher, he's a well-known researcher in the area of international franchising. He developed another review paper and he tried to publish this. However, he had tough time to publish this because many editors and reviewers came to know about our article on international, our review on international franchising, and they were declining, they were rejecting his review article on international franchising because our review article on international franchising is very, very comprehensive, and his review was not really comparable to our comprehensive review on franchising. So this is a problem if it's a recent review. So you have to avoid topics which is where there is a very recent review. Yeah, next point is methodology of a review paper. How do we start with? You need to decide journal selection criteria. What is meant by journal selection criteria? In order to do a classic literature review article, in order to develop a classic literature review paper, you need to decide what kind of journals you will select to source your papers. You need, that is your sample actually. When you do an empiric analysis, you conduct a survey and you have a sample size. Here also you need to have sample. And this sample has to come from journals, and you need to have, you need to use a criteria. And you can use a criteria like Web of Science journals, SSCI, that means you will search on the Web of Science database using the keywords, and then you will identify relevant articles. Criteria one could be Web of Science. Criteria two, another criteria. I mentioned here OR. That means it can be another criteria. Journals with impact factor 1+. Suppose you are doing a literature review in a very popular area where there are a lot of papers published. I would recommend you to think about this criteria, journals with impact factor 1+. However, the first criteria is okay, is considered as reliable if you are doing a literature review on a topic where there are not hundreds of papers. When you have hundreds of papers, you should select articles with a relatively high impact factor or UK ABS 3 and above, and likewise. But if your topic area doesn't have many papers, you can include papers from all Web of Science journals. So, and I move on to the next criteria, ABS 2 and above. ABS 2 means ABS is a UK ABS list, UK Association of Business Schools list. ABS two level journals are not really very premier journals. So this criteria is fine when you have a plan to do a review on a topic, when there are not hundreds of papers available in top journals, then ABS two and above is fine. So you need to decide that based on how many papers are available and whether to what extent people have done research and then decide this criteria. So recently, in Journal of Business Research, I handled a submission from France. They submitted a review paper using their sample coming from only from UK ABS 3 and above. They are not considering all Web of Science journal. They are not considering all journal with impact factor 1. So their criteria is ABS 3 and above. If you do that way, one problem is journals listed as 3 and above in ABS, if they all reject your paper, journals, those who are listed as below ABS 3, like ABS 2, will not consider your paper. If you only cite from, if your sample comes only from ABS 3 and above, ABS 2 level journals will not consider your paper. So you will have that problem. To avoid that problem, in all my review articles, I have criteria of impact factor 1 plus above. Some of my review articles are based on all Web of Science journals. I have never done a review article based on ABS 3 and above out of my 14 review articles, but I know some people do that. So, but they will have tough time if ABS 3 and above journals reject their paper to publish that paper somewhere else. That is a challenge. And I will tell you another example. ABDCA and ESTA. ABDC is Australian list. I received a request 2 years ago from a professor in Sydney asking me to co-author a review paper. And when I looked at the draft paper that they sent, it was PhD student work and originally and PhDs. That professor is not really capable. She's an Indian professor in Australia. She doesn't have much experience in research. She's almost, some people succeed in life with luck also. She is an example in that category. But she guided her PhD student to prepare literature review only based on ABDCA and ESTA. And that student did not do much work. Student did some cut and paste and all those kind of things. And it was tough. It was tough for that paper to get in an A or A star because it was not much work. So I'm not against A and A star, but you need to really craft a scientific paper based on your sample. So some people do literature review based on Scopus. So what you have to understand is Scopus has much more number of journals than Web of Science. Scopus is like an ocean. Suppose if you source papers from Scopus journal, that means the number of journals will be much more. For example, I tell you, MDI in India runs a journal called Vision. That is included in Scopus. But such journals are not in Web of Science because in order to get on SSCI or Web of Science, you need to have an impact factor. But a lot of regional, local, national journals are on Scopus, but they are not on Web of Science. Suppose if you say that I have my journal selection criteria is Scopus, you have actually challenged because you have to search all Scopus listed journals and you are likely to miss some relevant papers published in some regional Scopus listed papers. So I would not really recommend you to do Scopus based, but you can think about impact factor 1 and above or all SSCI journals or ABS 3 and above or ABS 2 and above. But Scopus, it will take a lot of work to do a literature review based on Scopus, and it is not required also. Article search criteria, you can use two search criteria. First criteria can be, you need to have keywords to search articles, and your keywords, when you download articles, when you use keyword to download articles, when you get all those articles, you can identify relevant articles based on one of these criteria. The first criteria can be keywords in title, abstract, or keywords of others' articles. If you are not happy with that, you can use the second criteria. Second criteria is your keywords in the article text or abstract. If you use the second criteria, you will get a lot of articles. You will get numerous articles. If you use the first criteria, you may not get a lot of articles, but if you use the second criteria, your sample will consist of hundreds of articles. Then you have to also read and use subjective criteria to select your inclusion exclusion criteria. If you use this second criteria, you have to also use your brain to finally arrive at your final sample. Yeah, so now I'm going to share one of my experience last year when I was serving as editor of review papers for International Business Review. We got 72 submissions and 20 plus papers didn't have any general selection criteria. They sourced articles from everywhere. They had articles from national journals, local journals, magazines, books. So they had everything. It was all mixed. That doesn't work in a classic literature review article. Many editors do not like that. Many reviewers do not like that. You need to have strict general selection criteria. You're not supposed to source articles or cite articles from regional, local journals and websites and all those kind of things in a classic literature review article. Keep in mind, such an approach of citing from all kind of journals, regional journals like Vigalpa and all, that will not work in an international global premier journal when you want to publish a literature review in a premier journal. You need to have strict general selection criteria. For example, Vikalpa from IIM Ahmedabad may be respectful in India, but it doesn't have any impact factor. It is not listed on SSCI. So you cannot cite from such journals when you want to submit to international journals. It can be empirical paper, but in literature review paper, general selection criteria is very important. So editors can, you know, so you have to explain general selection criteria, how you select sample and all those kind of things as part of your methodology when you write a literature review paper. And title of a literature review. Title should reflect what kind of article it is. I mentioned three titles here. Two of them are my article. The second one is hypothetical. Second one, I don't think that there is a review paper on that title. But first one and third one is my articles. And both published in Journal of Business Research. And the first one title is Masters Marketing, a Review and Research Agenda. And second one is Brand Equity Research, a Review and Future Research Agenda. And third one is International Franchising, a Review and Research Agenda. So in all this, the word review is highlighted, and in addition to review, in all this, what is also important is future research agenda is also included or highlighted. This is because, as I mentioned earlier, main purpose of a review article is to develop future research agenda. So ideally, in your title, the purpose of your literature review article should be reflected. That is your future research agenda, because you are doing this review to develop future research agenda. If you are not developing future research agenda, your review article is not going to be useful. Your review article will not be impactful. If you want to get citations, you have to develop detailed future research agenda. And editors, those who have flavor for impactful article, they will look for future research agenda in review article. It is not easy for a PhD student to write future research agenda. PhD student would need the support of a senior scholar to write future research agenda, because a PhD student doesn't have enough experience to write future research agenda. PhD student can do the first part, review, but future research agenda can be only prepared by a scholar who has enough experience in that field, because he has some idea what theories are used, what methods are used, and he has to also use his knowledge to write future research agenda section. The next point is sample size and time period. Sample size in a review article, at least 40 articles to be reviewed. at least minimum sample size should be 40, in my opinion. It could be 40 to 500, depending upon the number of articles. Suppose you're doing a review of 50 years of research, 30 years of research, 40 years of research, your sample size would be 400 or 500. But if you're doing a review based on 20 years of research or 10 years of research, your sample size will be small. Also, it varies from topic to topic. For example, if you're doing research on iCloud research, you may not find lots of papers because it's a relatively new area. So depending upon the area, depending upon the topic, you need to decide your sample size. Ideally, minimum should be 40. If you don't have at least 40, then there could be rejections. Time period of publication to be covered. Next point. Minimum 10 years to maximum 50 years. Yeah. And next important point, focus on findings of prior studies. It's important. And don't write a descriptive review, because very descriptive reviews do not have the probability of getting accepted. You need to have tables. For example, you can prepare tables to highlight studies with similar or same findings, or pool the studies with same findings. It's important. And demonstrate that in the table so that you can create rigor. Otherwise, reviewers or editors will say, your review doesn't have rigor. Sometimes papers go to reviewers, those who have never published a review article. In that case, you may be lucky. Some people are lucky because very well-published researchers decline to review. So sometimes editors have tough challenge to get consent from well-known experts, those who have expertise, exposure, and experience in review papers. So they might send your paper. So when such experts decline, your paper might go to relatively junior researchers, and they might accept your paper. So sometimes luck also play a role in life. Work, in my view, 80% work and 20% luck. So this is what is all about the life. So, but 80% is still work. That means you still have to work hard. Otherwise, you get lots of rejections. Yeah, so after this slide, I will try to take a quick break, and we can have questions and answers, Q&A.
Yes,
research
sir.
Gaps. Yeah.
Hello. Yes, sir. We have some questions from the attendees.
Okay.
So, okay. Can I discuss
one by one?
Yes, sir. So the first question, it is about most of the journal seek for the empirical papers. So in this case, how to attract the good journals with literature review or a bibliometric research paper? This question is from the Ganesha.
Yeah. So. That's what I'm saying. You need to write a rigorous review article. It has to be rigorous. So towards the end of my session, I have 2-3 slides where I'm specifically saying do's in a literature review. I have about 10 points, do's. You have to follow that strictly without fail, because you have to create rigor. If they find it, if there is no rigor, you will find it tough. Time to publish. Bibliometric, I'll come to the bibliometric also. I have my slide. I'm not a fan of bibliometric, to be frank with you. Bibliometric reviews are not very useful in my opinion, but sometimes some journal publish bibliometric. Okay. So okay, any other question?
Second question, it is about how to group research findings in order to understand the research gap.
Yeah. Yeah, so research findings and research gaps are two different issues. Research gaps, I was talking about research gaps based on widely used methods, widely used theories, and widely used variables and constructs. Research findings are different. So research gap need to be identified based on widely used theories. I already talked about technology acceptance model theory. Everybody has used that. Let's say you are conducting a review with 70 papers. And out of 70 papers, 60 researchers have used technology acceptance model. That means that model, that theory is widely used. So you have to, so that means research gap for the gap exists for using some other theories. So that you have to highlight. So findings of prior studies, that's a different issue. That is different from research gaps.
Okay. So the next question it is about, when we are preparing a research article, how many minimum references should be incorporated into the papers?
Yeah, in a review paper, that is my topic for today. That's what I mentioned. So it should be at least 40 in a review paper.
Okay, sir. One new question from the Uma. How do we search for the impact factor 1 or above? How do we use a filter and which search engine that we need to use for searching the paper?
Yeah, so let's say if you select like most of my review articles are based on Web of Science. But early days when I was not an expert in review article, I have also done review paper on Scopus and ABDC and all those. So selecting journals with 1+ impact factor, that requires manual processing. That requires you have to look at each journal website to each journal website gives impact factor and you have to look at that and decide that. So you have to do that only if you are doing a review on a very, very popular topic where thousands of articles are published, then you can use that criteria. Or if there are hundreds of articles published in a specific area, you can use ABS 3N plus criteria also. So So basically it's a manual process. I mean, in case if you want to select journals with 1+ impact factor, but if you want to select all journals with SSCI impact factor, you can simply source article from Web of Science.
One more question which is related with again a review article. Is there any standardized research format that we need to follow in a case of research article preparation?
Yeah, this is what I'm going to talk about now. I'm going to classify these review articles into different types and I'm going to explain that.
So Kiran sir, Upal here. And I think let us try to finish the talk of Professor Paul have. Professor Paul.
Please, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, so I mentioned here in my current slide, research gaps and directions for future research. In my previous slide, I talked about research agenda. That research agenda is the same as of directions for future research. It is the same. And the purpose of a review article is to provide these directions for future research. And I would recommend you to use a framework to provide these directions for future research, or directions for future research should be a dedicated, detailed section consisting of at least 8 paragraphs in a review paper. And based on a lot of rejections in the beginning, when I submitted review papers, I did not have enough exposure and experience. Many of my review papers got rejected in the beginning. Then I read some classic review papers published in Journal of Management and those kind of top journals. I learned about different framework and I developed some of my frameworks also. And I had an opportunity to work with Professor Gabriel Benito from BI Business School, Norway. He taught me how to do a review paper with a framework. ADO framework was born based on my discussion with Professor Benito from BI Business School, Norway. And we developed ADO framework. ADO framework stands for antecedents, decisions, and outcome. Then their review article is written using ADO framework. ADO framework can be used in any other all topics as well. And another framework which we developed was TMCC framework. TMCC stands for Trinamool Congress, but it also stands for theory, method, constructs, and characteristics, or it can be also context. So what theories? Then their review, you can use this framework to structure your entire review. And if it is difficult for you to structure your entire review using this framework, you can at least write directions for future research with reference to TMCC framework, theory, methods, constructs, and context. You know, so what context studies are already conducted, what context studies can be conducted is contacts means what country contacts and what industry contacts. So, you know, so you have, but this requires a lot of work. I mean, this can be done only, you know, if you have a lot of free time. If you're working in a teaching oriented institutions, then you cannot easily do this. So, but if you are doing PhD, you have time to do this. And about, or if you are working in a research oriented institution, you have time to do this. Otherwise, it takes a lot of time. Yeah. So, you know, TMCC or ADO or TCCM. TCCM is a reverse way of TMCC, the same thing, but CC comes before M. M is methodology or methods. So use one of this framework, and I have given a call for papers for International Journal of Commerce, International Journal of Consumer Studies, special issue, and that call is also available on the website of International Journal of Consumer Studies, and look at that. In that, we classify different review articles, and we have listed most downloaded review papers using, for, you know, review papers in all types, all categories of review papers. So I also mentioned at least 20% of weightage in your paper should be for directions for future research with reference to theory, methods, constructs, and contexts. And context can be industry context, what industry studies have been conducted, FMCG industry or pharmaceutical industry, IT industry, what industry studies can be conducted. So likewise, you can go on. For example, service quality. Service quality industry studies have been widely conducted. Service quality scale is widely used in banking industry, but there could be scope for using the same scale in information technology industry. So you have to look at all this and do it. And before I go on to different classification of review articles, I would also like to specify that review articles can be broadly classified as domain-based reviews, theory-based reviews, and method-based reviews. I repeat, domain-based, theory-based, and method-based. So those are broad classification. But today I'm not going to the broad classification. I'm going to specific classification of review articles into different categories. Category one or type one, structured review article. In a structured review article, you will have at least 10 table structuring the useful content from your sample articles. You need to structure it in tables and couple of graphs, couple of figures as well, structured review article. So this is called a structured because then your review is structured with several tables. And these are not software generated tables. This requires a lot of effort. So I published this mainly because my former PhD student, Alexander Rosada, I trained him to do this. And we worked together hard, and then we did a lot of manual preparation for preparing tables. If you look at this article from the Journal of Business Research, it is titled International Franchising, a Literature Review and Research Agenda. So it has 10 tables, and it is structured using those 10 tables. This is not a bibliometric review. This is a structured review. So now I'm classifying review articles into 7-8 type different categories and one by one. So in order to understand what is inside each type of review articles, you need to have wide reading, and you need to take note of this review article, the specimen article I'm talking about today. And then you have to read those articles. And in case if you need any of this article, you can email me if you don't have access to these articles. Some of them are my articles, some of them are somebody else's articles. And as I said, you can also read these specimen articles in the call for papers of International Journal of Consumer Studies, special issue for review articles. First category, structured review. And second category, framework-based review. Framework-based review, yeah. So there are several framework-based reviews. So 5-6 framework-based reviews I have come across. One of the framework-based review, which is a popular review article published in Journal of Business Research by CA and Reddy. They use 6W framework of Callahan, 6W framework. The entire review is written using 6W framework. I like that article, that review article. That's not my article, but that That article is one of the most cited articles these days. And I have done Adobe-based framework, Adobe framework-based view with Benito, and I have developed a TCCM framework, another article published in the National Marketing Review. So 6W framework is another useful framework. 6W framework was introduced by Callahan, and CA and Reddy, they have a review on cross-border mergers and acquisitions, a review published in Journal of World Business using 6W framework. So type two is framework-based review. The entire article is written using the framework. So framework can be, you know, you can either use one of this framework or you develop a framework and you have to structure everything using this framework. It takes time. It's not that fun. But if you do this, a lot of people will download your paper. A lot of people will find it useful and insightful, and they will cite. So if you're ambitious, you might have to think about it. And in my opinion, I classify all these 8, 9 type of review articles today. In my opinion, type two framework-based review is more impactful, and they get more downloads and citations because everything is put in a nice and scientific way. And type three, I go on theory-based review. Theory-based review, you know, you identify a theory and you look at the role of that theory in some subjects. For example, this is a review article using a theory. I mean, this is only one theory specified. Role of self-determination theory in marketing science, a review and research agenda. This is a review from European Management Journal. So self-determination theory, its role in marketing science. This is a review paper. Similarly, you can do another review, you know, role of theory of planned behavior in sustainability research, or role of theory of planned behavior in entrepreneurship research, or technology, role of technology acceptance model in information technology research. So likewise, agency theory, role of agency theory in franchising, role of institutional theory in international business. So you need to identify a theory which is applied in several research papers, and then you look at how they applied this, and you know, you have to analyze it, and then this kind of review papers are also insightful because this is useful for junior researchers to learn how to use a theory in their research, because a lot of journals want theory-based research. And Robert Palmashir has written a review paper on a very similar review paper, applying a theory in a marketing field, in sales research, sales and distribution research. So you can identify a theory and then look at that theory's application in a specific field. For example, you can look at maybe a role of service profit chain research, service profit chain framework, in the area of services marketing, you know. So likewise, you can identify a theory or model and look at how people have applied that theory in a specific field. It can be a specialized area of marketing, or it can be broad area of marketing, or it can be specialized area of entrepreneurship. For example, entrepreneurship, when you talk about entrepreneurship, it is too broad. So if you want to go more specialized, you can look at role of theory of planned behavior in international entrepreneurship. So that becomes, or role of theory of planned behavior in social entrepreneurship, more specialized way. So you identify a theory, and then you look at that theory's application in a specific subject area. There are several other theories also. I can name some theories. Attribution theory, behavioral decision theory, cognitive dissonance theory, cognitive theory, conflict theory, construct level theory, contingency theory, evolutionary theory, equity theory, prospect theory, expectancy theory, goal setting theory, Maastricht theory. There are several theories like that. So any of these theories you can look at in a specific field and develop a review paper. Yeah. Another type of review paper is systematic literature review, narrative type. You know, all this, what all these classifications I'm talking, all these falls under the broad category of systematic literature review. All these are SLR actually. So, but we are dividing or classifying all gamut of SLR into different types of reviews. So in a narrative review, most of the PhD theses, when students do PhD, they write a literature review chapter in this narrative way. They don't have many tables in that. They don't have figures. They write like a descriptive newspaper article. So, but sometimes some journals accept such articles also. So you know, I'm not I'm not against this type of article, provided you craft this scientifically in a descriptive way, focusing on sub-themes. Here, what people do is they focus on sub-themes. They don't focus on theory, they don't focus on methods, but they focus on what are the sub-areas or sub-themes research in a specific field. And they write a narrative review. For example, this one, I give an example of a specimen, a paper from Journal of Management. It's a very, very respectful journal, but sometimes if you have a very high profile author, you can get a paper published in respectful journal also. So this is a drawback of the entire academic system in any field, including medical science. If you have high profile author, sometimes your paper gets accepted. So this paper, it's a narrative review, but they focus on what research is done, focusing on sub themes or sub areas. And but they don't focus on methods. They don't focus on constructs and variable in this review. So this kind of reviews are also acceptable. And some journals publish this. I have also seen this kind of reviews in some other journals like Asia Pacific Journal of Management and so on. So this kind of reviews will have few tables, not many tables. In the first category, structured review, I talked about it, you have 10 tables, all structured, all manually prepared. And they are focused on theories, methods, constructs, context, and findings, all those in a structured review. So, but in narrative review, few tables. This narrative review will look like a more plain vanilla descriptive write-up. Type 5, the next category, bibliometric review. Many people do bibliometric review these days because it is very easy to do, because there is a freely available software called VOS Viewer, Visualization of Similarities. VOS Viewer stands for Visualization of Similarities. VOS stands for Visualization of Similarities. And in India, a lot of people are getting into this VOS Viewer software these days. There is also new NViewer, NewViewer software for this bibliometric review. So this is a different type of review paper. So in my view as an editor, I tend to desk reject bibliometric reviews. This is because you feed some data and software generates some graphs and tables. Many people reproduce and copy and paste those graphs and tables and they submit to journals. They think that that is a classic review. But bibliometric review, somebody created a software, but that doesn't mean that bibliometric review is impactful. Bibliometric reviews do not get enough citations compared to previously talked about four types of reviews. Number of citations of a bibliometric review is not much. There is a journal called Scindometrics. Scindometrics used to publish a lot of bibliometric reviews, but even they have stopped publishing bibliometric reviews these days. They publish hardly few bibliometric reviews. So, but I would also suggest that you can generate some tables or graphs from bibliometric review and then make it more hybrid. Suppose you use part of bibliometric software and make it hybrid with some framework like ADDO, TMCC, or 6W to provide directions for future research. Then your review moves on to a hybrid type of review, and that hybrid type of review will look better because it has tables, it has graphs, and you know it will look rigorous, because many times editors and reviewers, they do not read the entire paper, but they read abstract introduction and they look at tables and graphs, because it's easy to look at tables and graphs, and they might consider your paper. So review, yeah. But I would like to suggest a classic bibliometric paper from Journal of Production Innovation Management. Most of the bibliometric papers in journals I have seen, they are not of global standard, but there is a very good bibliometric review which I have seen in Journal of Production Innovation Management. This is by Randhwa et al. This is titled Open Innovation, a Bibliometric Review. Open Innovation Bibliometric Review, published in Journal of Product Innovation Management, is the classic bibliometric review which I recommend to people interested in bibliometric review. Otherwise, just by copying and pasting tables and figures from VoiceWeaver, I, as an editor, do not have an inclination to consider just copy and paste from VoiceWeaver because it's not really insightful. So you are only doing core citation analysis, core network analysis. What is the affiliation of the researchers when you do a bibliometric analysis using VoiceWeaver? It doesn't matter where they work. How does it matter for a researcher? So for researchers, they want to know what theories are used, what methods are used, what constructs and variables are used, what conduct studies are conducted. Such things are not captured in VoiceWeaver software. So that is the limitation of VoiceWeaver software. If VoiceWeaver software doesn't capture those kind of useful stuff, VoiceWeaver software has its own limitation. There are some researchers who have specifically pointed out the limitations of VoiceWeaver software. But if your objective is to publish a paper in some Scopus Index journal or some Web of Sciences or CI Impact Factor journal, some journals will publish bibliometric reviews. But getting a paper published in a premier journal with bibliometric review, you will have tough time to do that. So, but some editors, those are very senior, they might feel happy when they see some nice tables and figures because they would not even know that you have copied this from bibliometric review or they have copied, you copied this from VoiceWeaver because they have never used it. Sometimes you, if you're lucky, they will accept your paper if they have never used VoiceWeaver. But those who have actually seen VoiceWeaver know that these are copied figures and copied diagrams and copied tables from VoiceWeaver. They might have reservation. Recently, I was looking at reviews. Recently, I got a review paper on celebrity endorsement. I was handling as editor in Journal of Business Research. This paper went on to review to a very well-known expert and very unknown expert. Unknown expert gave minor revision. Well-known expert rejected the paper, stating all the limitations of bibliometric software, how it is useless and all those kind of things. As an editor, I am confused what decision to take because unfortunately I sent this paper to an unknown reviewer because well-known reviewers were declining review invitation and unknown reviewer has given only minor revision and well-known reviewer who agreed to review, he has rejected the paper. So this is a dilemma sometimes editors face. Yeah, so, but in any case, VoiceWeaver software generate nice figures which help to score in presentation dimension. Some reviewers like very nicely presented papers. Type 6 is meta-analysis. Meta-analysis is also kind of review paper. Meta-analytical paper actually analyzes the effect of something on something. These are review papers based on sample papers of, you know, let's say you have to identify effectiveness of something on something and you collect articles and then you carry out a meta-analysis. And this is software-based. You know, meta-analysis can be done on using several softwares. I mentioned some of the softwares here, MetaExcel and so on. And one of the classic meta-analysis paper that I would like to recommend to you is Nolan Mathers, 2007. Effectiveness of Celebrity Endorsement and Meta-Analysis published in Journal of Academy of Marketing Science. It's a very comprehensive meta-analysis. And even MIS Quarterly has published several classic meta-analysis papers. So, yeah. I move on because we need to have some time for questions and answers. Type 7 is review papers with theoretical or testable propositions. So here, almost all articles in Academy of Management Review and Academy of Marketing Science Review, AMS Review and AMR falls in this category. So the goal of this type of review article is to develop theoretical and testable proposition. And this kind of review article will consist of at least 5 or 6 theoretical proposition which can be tested by future researchers. The goal of this review article is to develop this kind of proposition. why these propositions are important is future researchers can use these propositions as their hypothesis and test. When they use your proposition as their hypothesis and test, they will cite your paper. So this kind of review articles are also impactful. That is why Academy of Management review has very high impact factor. And you, this kind of review articles can also aim for theory development or framework development. Like I did a review and developed a 7P framework for international marketing. So this is based on a review article. And the 7P framework is original. And this consists of 7P framework, consists of performance is equal to function. Performance is a function of potential, path, process, pace, pattern, and problems. Performance is considered as a function of all those other 6 P's. And this 6 P's, is this including this first P, performance, is demonstrated and presented and introduced and developed as a framework which is useful for any companies, those who want to expand their business beyond their country. It can be also for useful for regional expansion. It can be useful. It's a framework useful for companies' business growth and expansion and strategies and survival, especially in the recession time, and all this framework is very useful. This framework is developed using a review, using review. And there are a lot of articles, I repeat, in Academy of Marketing Science review, AMS review, and Academy of Management review. They publish this type of review papers. Yeah, so review focusing on theory development, type 7. So I repeat, so you need to have a proposition in such papers ideally when you have this kind of review papers. Yeah, so and one or two of examples I would like to share is some experience. Before I took over as editor-in-chief of International Journal of Consumer Studies, I was working as associate editor for review articles for Services Industries Journal. I did that for 1.5 years. Recently, I quit that job because I'm overloaded now as editor-in-chief. So, but when I was working, we got a submission from an IIT PhD student, IIT Delhi PhD student. The submission was a review paper on microfinance in South Asia. And chief editor of the journal did not like it because he said, this is a review on microfinance in South Asia. This is not a review on microfinance in the entire Asia. This is not a review on microfinance throughout across the countries. We need reviews focused on a domain or focused on a theme. And it has to be globally applicable because what is applicable in setting A should also be applicable in setting B. But this review is just focused on South Asia. South Asia means India. That means he should publish this in an Asian journal instead of publishing in a global journal. So, and he wanted to desk reject that. So my suggestion to you is that when you are targeting a global journal, which is published for global audience, don't try to do a review focusing on studies, focusing on one region or one country. You need to identify studies in different country context and carry out a review with a global focus. Otherwise, journals with global focus might reject your paper and will ask you to submit your paper in some Indian journal or in a regional journal. So now I'm specifically coming back to some specific tips or do's of developing. When you develop a review paper, what are the do's that you have to keep in mind? Number one, do plagiarism check before submission. It's very important because literature review articles are bound to have relatively high similarity. Make sure that you reduce similarity. Agenda two or step two, or point two. Make sure that you submit to a journal from which you have cited papers. Step three, rigor in a review article should be demonstrated with the help of at least 4 or 5 tables and 2 or 3 figures, at least. It should not be copied and pasted from software. It should be originally drawn. Copied and pasted figures can be, I mean, you can copy and paste maybe maximum 1 or 2 figures, but all figures, if you're copied, editor or reviewer will find it out. And step four, or agenda four, pool studies with similar findings in table format. and cite with the author name in the table in second column and with the findings, pooled findings. This is a classic way of reporting studies in an academic writing setup. Number five, avoid citation from websites and avoid citation from local or regional journals. It's important, especially in a review article, it's very, very important. Because if editor sees regional journal citation, they get irritated, they will desk eject your paper. And tip six, get it English edited by someone. Could be your own student in your class. Make an announcement in your own class that I want your help in case if you're looking for, you know, helping me, you know, I can give you some kind of monetary incentive. You can read my article and get it proofread or English edited. And because as a researcher, you need a nurse. Your student can be your nurse, but if your student doesn't have time to help you, you have to get it English edited and proofread by somebody outsider. Somebody, you know, someone else has to read your paper with fresh eye. So it might cost you some rupees or some dollar, but it is worth, especially when research is getting rewarded in a big way these days. You know, in many business schools these days, there are monetary incentives for research. Like IIMs are paying very attractive remuneration for their faculty to publish these days, or even private institutions like IMI or government institutions like Indian Institute of Foreign Trade, they are paying a lot of benefits for their faculty. Even one of the IIFT faculty member, he even approached me and he even offered me bribe to publish his paper because his institute is paying him attractive sum, you know. So people are desperate to publish. There is a lot of competition. Make sure that you implement or you take all these things very seriously. It's important because sometimes you work very, very hard, but you don't have the little push in the right direction. Your paper get rejected. You have some errors in your paper get rejected. In early stages of my career, when nobody knew me, when nobody recognized me, I have had a lot of rejection, 500+ rejections in my life. So keep in mind, it's very easy to get a rejection, but it's tough to get a paper accepted. So it requires a lot of patience, it requires a lot of efforts. And if you are having that kind of dedication and determination, you can do it. Nothing is impossible. Everything is possible, provided you're willing to work very hard and you have dedication, determination, and the vision and mission to undertake this challenge. And you can convert these challenges as opportunities. There are a lot of opportunities in research. I would like to wish you all the best, and I would like to take up some questions in case, if time permits, we can have more questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Before we discuss questions from the attendees, is there any question from the panel member, please? Hello? Questions from panel member?
Yes, sir. I have a question.
Yes.
It's about what is your advice related to self-citation in the review article? Should we, is it encouraged self-citation in the review article?
Well, I'll share my experience. I co-authored a review article on master's marketing. Actually, I worked, master's marketing is actually my brainchild. The concept of master's marketing, but I co-authored a paper, and when I co-authored a review paper on master's marketing, I had to cite my papers because I have 5 papers, and I'm the only one with 5 papers in that area. Every other author has 1 or 2 papers in that area, so my papers had to be cited 5 times in that paper, and we did it. We submitted to Journal of Marketing Management. Editor Mark specifically sent back this article. He didn't straight away reject it, and he said that it looks like a self-citation based review, and he got jealous. Sometimes it's also because of jealousy. Sometimes some authors intentionally do that everywhere in the article, in every paragraph. If you do that intentionally every paragraph, editors and reviewers will be jealous. To be frankly, they will be jealous. And jealousy will create, jealousy will block them to accept your paper. So, but I'm not saying that you should not self-cite everywhere. But in case if it is very important to cite your paper, you can cite, but don't cite it everywhere.
Okay, sir. Understood.
Sir, I am Dr. Hiren Patel from Ganpat University. Sir, my question is related to plagiarism free writing. Sir, what care we should take while drafting a paper so as to minimize this similarity index?
You have to check on the software, right? Turnitin or some other software and reduce the similarity. You have to rewrite it.
Okay.
So let me also, if I share my editor experience, regarding plagiarism, it's a shocking experience. 20% of the submissions are plagiarized. A lot of them are self-plagiarized. Submissions from developed countries like Australia are self-plagiarized. Submission from IIT Bombay, MDI, a lot of submissions from different well-known institutions I have received as an editor are plagiarized.
Sir, up to what percentage of similarity that can be accepted in a case of reputed research journal?
It should not exceed more than 20%. And also you should not have copied more than 5% from any single source.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Requesting other panelists if they have their questions. Or we can take up few questions from the audience then.
Yeah, ma'am. We have at least 2 to 3 questions from the audience also, attendees also. How to find a good and demanding research topic when we start drafting a research article?
You have to look at with the novelty. Suppose if there are 1,000 papers published, do a Google Scholar search, you know. So when you do a Google Scholar search, you can easily find out or figure out how many papers are published in that area, right? So in case if thousands of papers are already published, there is no novelty. So you need to find a topic where there are, I was like 5 years ago, I was searching for, I had this very similar question. So I found an answer when I read a Harvard Business Review article. So this was in that the concept mass prestige, mass plus prestige was conceived and presented. And there were not much papers. I took it as a challenge and I developed a scale. I developed a theory called Maastricht theory. Maastricht means score scale for brand management and test. And to estimate the mass prestige value, brand equity of premium brands and such things. So, I mean, you can identify some topics like that, relatively green topic. There are not much research, but there are a lot of topics, 1,000 plus papers or 2,000 plus papers published. So there is no newness and novelty and people still keep doing same thing in a new bottle.
Okay, thank you, sir. Now only last question from the attendees. Is there any software available for the data visualization in the case of review article development?
Can you ask this again?
Yeah, sir. Is there any software available for data visualization in the case of reviews?
Softwares for review visualization is VoiceViewer and NBVO. So VoiceViewer is a freely available software. Bibliometric studies are conducted using VoiceViewer. And there is no harm in using VoiceViewer. You can use it, you can source some figures from VoiceViewer, some or one or two tables from VoiceViewer can be sourced, and then you can make it hybrid. So you can take figures using VoiceViewer and then you do some manual work, then it becomes a hybrid review. I didn't mention about hybrid review in my PPT, but some people do hybrid reviews with the help of VoiceViewer software. It's a free software, open source software. And then you do some manual work and then it becomes hybrid.
Okay, thank you, sir. As the session is really very excellent, and that's why we got a special request from the attendees that if possible, then in the future, Ganpat University should arrange another session with Professor Paul, sir, on international business. So this is just a special request from the attendees. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. We'll talk about it later.
Right, sir. Sir, would you like to take more questions or shall we end this session?
Yeah, ma'am. Please, you may go ahead.
it's up to you. If you have one or two more questions, I can answer one or two more questions.
All right. We have a question from Dr. Harsha Zariwala. She says the research paper based on some themes are still not published in A or A plus category or Web of Science. Then can we use papers for literature review, publish in B or C category, and Scopus and develop a review paper targeting A category or higher impact factor?
There are several top journals publishing review papers these days. I'll tell you, in management, in the subject area of management, which include human resource management, strategic management, and all, several top journals are publishing review papers last 10 plus years or more than that. But in marketing, it has not been common. But marketing, the type 7 review papers that I talked about with proposition, that kind of review papers were common in marketing for several years now. But these are all evolving, and marketing used to be quantitative techniques based. But these days, some marketing journals, like now Journal of Academy of Marketing Science, an annual special issue for review papers, Journal of Business Research. Now I'm serving as the managing or lead guest editor of review papers for Journal of Business Research. And this Journal of Business Research is a really A-star journal with 4.1 impact factor in America. In America, publishing a paper in Journal of Business Research means tenure, means job permanency or promotion. And in the UK and France, Journal of Business Research is a top journal. In ABDC, it is not top, it is only A, in A, because everywhere, you know, if editors don't influence decision makers, some journals will be A instead of A star in ABDC or wherever. In ABDC, Australasian Journal, where editor is based in Australia, is ranked as A, which doesn't have any impact factor. But this journal is ranked as lowest category journal in UK ABS. At the same time, UK ABS ranked British Journal of Management as top journal in UK because they are British. Politics is everywhere in the world, not only in India. Politics is everywhere.
Thank you, sir. The next question says, it's from Megha Sharma. She says that can we have bibliometric analysis for finding quality papers, topic, etc. for review of literature? So she says, can we have bibliometric analysis for finding quality papers?
Bibliometric analysis based review. If you just do a pure bibliometric analysis based review, sometimes publishing that in a top journal will be tough. That is why I suggested you need to have a hybrid. If you are a fan of bibliometric, you need to have a bibliometric. If you make, let's say, bibliometric plus, if you use one of the framework I suggested, or you develop your own framework and you do a domain based review, so then you have a better chance. Just by doing a bibliometric review from Voice Viewer, your publishing probability in a premier journal is not high.
Right, sir. Another question is from Ms. Smriti Rekha Sahu. She says, when we write a review paper, which is the most appropriate procedure according to the concept which has been discussed? Which is the most appropriate procedure?
Procedure in sense that I presented 7 types of review article.
Yes.
It is difficult to say which one is the best type. So each person can have different type of view. But for general selection criteria, I would recommend Web of Science. And, because Web of Science means, or SSCI journals, journals with impact factor, you can source all articles from one database. That is an advantage of Web of Science. And, but methodology of review article, you know, I talked about structured review, I talked about framework-based review, I talked about narrative review, I talked about reviews with propositions. So, you know, all these are different types. So I would suggest that you spend at least 1 week time to read all these classic examples of different types of review articles. Just by listening to me, you only have some ideas, but you have to also read those specific review articles I mentioned, or they are also listed in our call for papers of special issue for International Journal of Consumer Studies. It's on the journal website. And you read those articles first. How did I learn? I learned that by reading such a classic, most downloaded articles in different journals. That is how I learned. So you have to read those articles also. So because you have to do your homework so that you can, have more expertise.
Thank you very much, sir. We'll take up the last question. The questions are, participants are keeping on writing the questions, but let's take up the last one. It says that, Mr. Sudeep Kumar says that, can it be a good idea to develop SLR on a topic that is very new, but the number of articles will be less than 40 to be reviewed?
Yeah, so this, somebody can say that, editor or reviewer can say that this topic, this research area is not matured enough. You're not supposed to do a review of a paper when a subject area is not matured enough. If the number of papers are not many, for example, you can do a method-based review. There is a category called method-based review. Suppose there is a new method. So if there are not many studies, you can do a method-based review. But in order to do a domain-based thematic review, you need to have at least a minimum 40 sample size. It's kind of thumb rule. It's not a law, but it's a kind of thumb rule. I repeat, it's not a law.
Right, sir. So we come to the end of the session. And I would like to thank Professor Justin Paul for giving his insight on a wonderful topic, which is really an art to write literature review. I would like to thank all the panelists who have joined today to encourage us in this endeavor. We would like to thank all the participants for the enthusiastic participation and the questions that they have asked. We apologize, we were not able to take up all the questions, but definitely we'll request Paul sir, if he can keep interacting with all of us in future, there will be an opportunity to share his expertise with us. Thank you very much, all the participants, for attending the webinar. My request would be if you can share your experiences, observation, and compliments for the webinar, please put it in the chat box.